Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 through 24 is what we'll read first. I'm preaching a message this morning that I've titled Sibling Rivalry. To be honest with you, it's not a thing on the surface, because really my message isn't a literal interpretation anyway. It's more of a symbolism type thing. So the sibling rivalry, don't be fooled by the title. And really, maybe at first you won't even understand why I use that title, but before the message is over, you'll understand it, I believe. When it comes to sibling rivalry in a literal sense, I'm sure that this is a concept that psychologists have come up with. Most people understand that I'm not much of a proponent of psychology, but at least not therapeutically. But the truth is that they've also studied the development of children. And what they would say, that the biggest battle regarding sibling rivalry is that really they're trying to create and really to preserve and to maintain their own identity. That's really one of the biggest issues that you have in that particular scenario. In other words, I don't want to be known as Mary's little brother, or I don't want to be known as David's little sister. They want their own identity, if that makes sense, and they want to maintain it. They want to preserve it. Well, in a similar fashion, our new birth in Christ also produces a new identity in us. Amen? It produces a new identity. It produces a new way of life. But I have to be honest with you, the first birth, the old man, He doesn't want to go away. He wants to preserve his own identity. And so what we're going to do this morning is that we're going to look at some various aspects of that. You know, I was thinking recently about, about really my own girls, you know, and the fact that they're kind of getting tired of sleeping in the same room. I told them, well, you know, we're going to try to make a plan that no matter where we move, no matter how we upgrade, if it was up to me, then even if y'all got married, I know this is kind of weird, but it was a point that I didn't really think it through when I said it. I said, I'm going to work out a deal where y'all got to sleep in the same room together for the rest of your life. That probably wouldn't work. But anyway, I was thinking, because, you know, it's like I'm tired of hearing that. But the reality of it is that at some point in time, people are trying to create their own identity, and they want to maintain, they don't want to be associated with the other person, and sometimes they'll strive and fight in order to keep that identity or to create that identity. First, we're going to start off in Ephesians chapter 4, 17 through 24. Once again, we're ministering from the title of Sibling Rivalry. So let's go ahead and get started. It says, "This I say therefore and testify in the Lord, that you henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk." So let's just take a quick second and let's talk a little bit about some of where we've already been right here. The word henceforth is Old King James, and it means from this day moving forward. From this day moving forward, you're not supposed to walk as the other Gentiles walk. Now, we may not need to do this, but we're going to do it anyway, because we don't really know what everybody understands about the scripture. The word Gentiles essentially is talking about every single person on the earth at this point in time that was not Jewish by origin, Jewish by birth, because it was the Jewish people that understood the things of God. When we talked about the book of Romans, even just last week, it says in Romans chapter 3, what is the advantage then of being a Jew? Paul said, much in every way, for unto them were committed the oracles of God. What is the oracles of God? The utterances of God. God's word, God's voice literally spoke to mankind and was recorded in this word. It was given to the Jewish people, amen, to be the oracle of God. And today in modern time frames where you and I live, it's the Christian's responsibility also to carry forth with them in the midst of this fallen earth the oracle of God. So the Gentiles are those people that don't know God. They're those people who have lived their lives separate from God. Paul would tell the Ephesians also, and such were some of you. Because there was a time frame in each and every one of our lives where we were just like them. Amen? Before we were born again, before we gave our heart to Christ, before the Holy Spirit took residence on the inside of us, we were just like them. Our life was no different. And so he goes on, but listen, because he's talking to a Christian church. He's talking to Christians. From this day forward, you shall not walk as the other worldly folk walk. You shouldn't walk the way that the world walks, in the vanity of their mind. Now, the word vanity, I don't know what you get a picture of whenever you consider the word vanity, but many times you would consider a person maybe looking in the mirror at themselves. looking at, you know, paying attention to how, I don't know, whatever, how many wrinkles they have, how their hair looks, you know, what their body looks like, vanity. Well, the reason that the idea of vanity or being vain is connected to that is because somebody that has at least a little bit of understanding understands that in reality, in the grand scheme of things, the looks, the beauty, the appearance, it's relatively empty. And that's what the word means. It's vanity means emptiness. That's what the original idea is that it was empty. And so these Gentiles, they walk in the vanity of their mind. They are empty of the truth of God, having their understanding darkened. They're alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart, who being past feeling have given themselves over unto lasciviousness to work all uncleanness with greediness. But you have not so learned Christ. Now, we've talked about that many times. I hate to bore you, but the word Christ, it means the Messiah, the anointed one, the promised one. Amen. What's his last name? It's the one that God foretold for thousands of years that he would come to bring deliverance, to bring salvation. Israel was waiting on him. He showed up. Now we've got to tell the Gentiles about it. The church of Ephesus is a church of Gentiles. They didn't have the oracles of God, but now they're saved and God lives in their heart. And he's letting them know, but you have not so learned Christ, if so be that you have heard him. You know, I would preach this to a lot of people in the modern church today, and I don't mean it to be ugly, because I also definitely fit this bill. I certainly am far from having figured it all out. Lord knows that's the truth. But at least I have a somewhat of a rudimentary understanding of the gospel now. I can tell you, for a long time, I didn't really understand the gospel. I sat under teachers, people that meant well. I'm not picking on them, but I did not understand. So the question is, if so be that you have learned of him, if it be true that you truly are saved and you're truly being taught the principles of the Christ, and that the gospel is truly entering into your hearts and your mind is being awakened to the things of God, then guess what? You're not the way that they are, because you're not the same person that you used to be. He says, if you've been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus. Now, this is good. That you put off concerning the former conversation, another word for lifestyle, the way you handle your life, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. And that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. So what Paul is explaining here is that there's a new birth that takes place. And in this new birth, the old man in your first birth, which was born of Adam, he dies. You put him away. And then there's a new birth, and the new man, which is born again in Christ, he's the one that's now has resurrection life, and he's the one that's supposed to be living. Now, Paul wrote this letter to the Ephesians, and he's instructing them to quit living their lives, like I said already, the way that the world is living their lives. And some of the things that he talked about, once again, the emptiness or the vanity of their mind. He talked about the fact that their understanding was darkened. And lately we've been talking a lot about light, and that where there's an absence of light is really what it means to be darkness. And without light, you can't see. And we talked about that vision physically is dependent upon light. If the light can't touch the retina of the eye, then for whatever reason, then vision cannot properly take place. In the spiritual sense, Jesus is the light. And you have to be born again in order for the light of God to enter in. The Gentiles, those people who are of the first birth, those people who are not of the Lord and have not been saved, cannot see the things of God. And so their understanding is darkened. And they're not born again in that sense. They're alienated from the life of God.
Amen.
You know, I couldn't think of a better way to describe alienated. I didn't want to talk about aliens, even though aliens come from a foreign place. They're separate from where we are. But really, you know, it'd be kind of like the idea of back whenever I was somewhat of a mess. You know, I was a pretty big mess. And, you know, there comes a time whenever you've heard families say, you're alienated now from this family. You're no longer welcome here. And you can hear the door slam shut. You can hear the deadbolt lock. And now you're separated from the presence of the family. In a similar sense, the Gentile people who are not born again, who don't have the light of God, are alienated from the life of God. They're shut out or separated. And the blindness of their heart. The scripture said their heart was blind. The word really blindness there, when you look into it, it talks about callousness. It talks about a callous being formed over the heart, a hardened area. You know, callousness takes place to our hearts spiritually whenever through multiple times that the Holy Spirit's been trying to deal with us and to convict us in an area. When we begin to tune out the Lord, it starts to develop a callous on our heart. Our heart becomes hardened to the voice of God, to the plan of God, to the will of God. And more that we resist the conviction of the Holy Spirit, the harder our hearts get and the easier it is for us not to hear the voice of the Lord. Those who are whose hearts are disconnected from God are only concerned about what makes them feel good. And they're only concerned about what makes them feel good right now. They're not worried about God's plan. They're not worried as much about eternity. They're not even really worried too much about the future. They're worried about right now. And it talked about the fact that they would walk in lasciviousness. The word lascivious means literally unbridled lust. And I hope we at least got a bridle on us, right? A bridle and a bit. Whenever you got saved, the Lord should have put a bridle and a bit in your mouth. Amen. And the reality of it is that, you know what a bridle does? It can say, whoa, boy, and pull you back a little bit, right? But the truth is that those that are alienated from the life of God, they're different. They don't have a bridle or a bit in their mouth. And they're just ripping and running and they're going in a certain direction because they're alienated from the life of God and they don't even understand the things of God. But we aren't like them. We aren't of the world. We are of a new birth. Amen. And God desires to do a work in our life. We're of a second birth. We're new creations. Amen. And we have a new way of living. Amen. Now, you and I have talked about this before. I believe that God is a literary genius. Amen. And, you know, if God can write, I mean, if man can write with the concept of symbolism where there's a, you know, on the surface, there's a specific narrative or story that we're reading, and man can even come up and write underlying deeper meaning within that, that is called symbolism. And as you're reading along the story, you're like, man, this is a good story. And then all of a sudden, as you go, you're like, wait, hold on a second. The author's doing something here, and there's something bigger that lies below the surface. What's he trying to communicate? You understand what I'm saying? Well, certainly if man can do that, then I know that God can do that. Amen? And I believe that he has, certainly. And I want us to look a little bit at the births of brothers. That's where the sibling rivalry title comes in. And I want us to look at the births of brothers. Now, we can go on and on with this because this theme is prevalent in the Old Testament, but I'm just going to cover three this morning. And what I want us to specifically look at is the birth of the older versus the birth of the younger. And I want to look at the rivalry that takes place between the two. All right. And I want to consider briefly how they relate to the old man and the new man and how they relate to our Christian walk with the Lord. The first set of brothers I want to talk to you about comes out of Genesis chapter 25. And we're going to read verses 24 through 34. We're talking about Jacob and Esau this morning. It says, and when her days, let me give you a second to get there. Genesis 25, verses 24 through 34. It says, when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red all over, like a hairy garment. I want you to pay attention to that word red there. And they called his name Esau. And after that came his brother out. And his hand took hold on Esau's heel. And his name was called Jacob. And Isaac was 20, so 60 years old when she bare them. And the boys grew. And Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field. And Jacob was a plain man, dwelling in tents. And Isaac loved Esau, because he did eat of his venison, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Now, I can tell you that on the literal surface, there is actually a good reason for there to be a true sibling rivalry in this situation. But we're not really preaching a practical message on sibling rivalry this morning. We're not preaching on the fact, although it should already be in your heart, that you're not supposed to have favorites towards your children, right? And it doesn't mean that they didn't love the other one. It simply means that they did. They showed favoritism. And this is a good... Now, my kids will swear to you that oh, you love this one more, and you let this one get... That's the biggest bunch of garbage that I've ever heard in my life. I have no favorites. Some people act a certain way and they get fussed whenever they act a certain way, but I love my kids the same. I can't convince them of that. They got their own things that they believe in their heart, but it's not right to have favorites and to show favoritism. And it will breed. Now, because see, the enemy, I'm telling you, if he's doing it in my kids, then because it isn't true, but he puts it in their minds. And just think if they're in an environment where they do see that. Just think what the enemy is putting on the inside of... Can we just soon talk about practical sibling rivalry for a second too, since that's the title of the message. You got to understand something, that we're dealing with spirituality, amen? And the enemy of your soul and the enemy of your children's soul wants to destroy them, wants to cause problems for them, and wants to prevent them also from walking with the Lord. And if there's the slightest little thing that he'll jump on that, and he'll begin to try to convince them in their heart and in their mind that it is true that their parents show favoritism. But that's not what we're really talking about this morning. We're talking really about sibling rivalry from a spiritual sense. The firstborn versus the secondborn. The Bible goes on to say next that Jacob sod pottage. What does that mean? It means he was cooking some food. And the word pottage there really is describing a big old bowl or a big old pot of what you'd call lentils today, which is kind of like a form of a bean. And Esau came in from the field, and the Bible says he was faint. And Esau said to Jacob, "Feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage." So Esau was born red. The pottage was red. He says, "For I am faint," and therefore his name was called Edom. Jacob said, "Sell me this day your birthright." And Esau said, "Behold, I am at the point to die. And what profit shall this birthright do to me?" And Jacob said, "Swear to me this day." And he swore unto him, and he sold his birthright unto Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and pottage of lentils, and he did eat and drink, and rose up and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. So the story goes that there were two twins that were inside their mother Rebecca's womb. I don't know if you noticed or not. Well, I tried to make you realize it, but the word red was used multiple times. The word red was used to describe Esau when he came out, that he was all hairy like a red garment. It also said that the pottage was red. And then you probably didn't know this unless you remember me telling you before, because I have told you before, that the word Edom is connected also to the word Adam. These two words in the Hebrew language actually mean the same thing. And what they mean is red. And the reason that Adam means red is because God formed him out of the red dirt of the earth and breathed life into him. And so the name Adam essentially means red. And Edom means red. And because Edom was red, and because he went after the red stuff, the reality of it is that's why his name was changed from Esau to Edom. Now, one of the things that I want you to be aware of is this, is that there's no question that the red symbolically is representative of the things of this world. The red is representative of the earth from which Adam was taken. And because he is the firstborn, see, this represents you and I in our birth of Christ. The first time we're born of Adam, we're born of the earth, we're born of the red stuff. And the second time birth, we're born of Jesus. It's a spiritual birth. It's our new birth. And the two siblings are representative of the two births. We have the first birth of Esau, which represents the old man that the Ephesians passage talked about. And that, what's he going after? He's drawn towards the red stuff. He wants the things that the world has to offer him. The natural man does not consider the things of God. He's not interested in the spiritual aspect of God. But listen to me. Not only that, I want you to notice, look what he did. He sold his birthright. What does a birthright even mean? The birthright was given to the firstborn in a family. And I can tell you, there are several places and instances where this very thing happens. The birthright wasn't supposed to be given to Ishmael. We'll talk about him in a second too. It was for Isaac. The birthright was supposed to be for Reuben, but because of the failure that he made, it ended up going to Judah. The birthright was not given to the firstborn of Joseph's sons, but it was given to the secondborn of Joseph's sons. Because the reality of it is that many times the firstborn, and once again, it's representative of the first birth, that which is carnal, that which is the old man, that which has the natural desires and does not want to go towards the things of God. And so the first brother represents the first birth in Adam. The second brother represents the new birth in Jesus. He despised his birthright. What does that mean? Once again, the birthright was connected to the firstborn, and it also had something to do with a double blessing. So the firstborn was able to have a double blessing in his life. What is that talking about? Well, if there were four siblings, and daddy had 4,000 head of sheep, then the firstborn was able to get to a double portion, and then the last three siblings had to split what was left over. So the firstborn would get 2,000 sheep, and the next three siblings had to split the other 2,000 between them. But not only that, when it came to the people of God in ancient times, it was specifically connected to the idea of what we've been talking about, Messiah. Because God was promising all the way back from the garden, whenever Adam and Eve fell, that the seed of the woman would come into the earth and that he would bring new life, he would bring victory, he would be the access point back into the presence of God. And as Israel, this is even before Israel's even formed, but as they pass these stories down and they're in preparation for the arrival of Messiah, the birthright is connected to that. See, Esau, Jesus didn't come from Esau's lineage. Jesus came from Jacob's lineage. Jesus didn't come from Reuben's lineage. Jesus came from Judah's lineage. And it goes on and on. Jesus didn't come from the first one. This is something different. They're not siblings. Didn't come from Saul's lineage out of Benjamin. No, he came out of David's lineage, out of David. Not the first, but the second. And we see this repetitive theme within the scriptures. Esau wasn't worried about his future. The birthright was connected to the future. Esau was worried about today. And the same thing happens in people's lives, especially before they know the Lord. They're just living for today. I want some of that rich stuff, which represents the things that the world has to offer. I don't want it tomorrow. I don't even want it a couple hours from now. I want it right now because I want my flesh to feel good. And I wanted my flesh to feel good right now. So give me some of the stuff that the world has to offer. He wanted it, and he wanted it right now. I was thinking to myself, you know, how many times do people in their lives do the same thing? They don't really think about their future a lot, at least not spiritually. They might think about their future in a carnal sense, but they don't really think about eternity. They don't think a lot about what God has to say about certain things. You know, I was thinking about the fact that so many people have sex before marriage. Now, the world doesn't even know anything about that. I mean, listen, when you're in the world, it's like that. Sometimes I talk to kids in the clinic. You do what you want with this. I used to talk to almost every teenager that came through there. And I would explain to them what the Bible says. And some of them, they would laugh at me. But it was cool because it gave me a little open door to try to talk to them a little bit. But, you know, before long, one day the Lord just spoke to my heart. He said, when the door opens, that's fine, but if you expect them to act like a Christian, then you're not really using your brain too much, because the reality of it is that they're not a Christian. The light of God has not entered into their heart. Therefore, they don't know the difference, and you can try to tell them. You'll plant some seeds in their life, and hopefully with time that seed will turn into a harvest, amen? But the reality of it is that until my light enters into their heart, they're not going to understand a thing about what you're saying. But the people of God, listen, youth groups in America have been dealing with this kind of thing for a long time. The young people in the church deal with this, lust issues. Young people in the church deal with lust issues. They start dating. Listen, we used to be involved in youth groups in churches that they wouldn't allow you know, any kind of dating, or they'd call it PDA, no PDA, no public display of affection. And sometimes they'll go to the extreme of making the boy sit on one side and making the girl sit on the other side. That ain't gonna work. That's a system of rules and regulation. I appreciate your attempt. I don't think that we should really endorse dating at a young age. This is my reason behind that. I mean, you know, I didn't plan on bringing all this up, but since I did, let me explain to you why. Why don't you endorse dating? You got to give me some reasoning here, preacher, because I've never heard anybody talk like this before. Okay. So the scripture's real clear that we're not supposed to have sex before marriage. Now, you can do what you want with that. You can think I'm crazy. You can go home and say, man, that dude's whacked out. I don't believe that way. This is what I did when I'm growing up. And if it was good for me, then it's okay. Well, that's fine. But the Word of God says something different. Mm-hmm. The Word of God says something different. It says that sex before marriage is not okay. Amen. And so if sex before marriage isn't okay, and we have been called by God to teach our children His principles, His Word, and to live their lives according to His characteristics, then that means we're to teach our children that they aren't supposed to have sex Amen. Before marriage. Now, anybody in here, I don't know if you know this or not, but there's demon spirits connected to this thing called lust.
Amen.
Now, did you know, I used to try to explain this to my daughters. And you know, listen, I'm far from gotten having it all figured out. But I have a little bit of understanding in this area. I can tell you right now that even though something as simple as holding someone's hand leads to holding and embracing someone, leads to a little Amen. Kiss. Next thing you know, you're making out with them. Next thing you know, they're touching you in a way that you, and guess what? With time, if you allow that to happen, now it's one thing to maybe a girl or I don't know that a boy would do this, but I guess anything's possible if he was trained, right? But if you had a girl who she liked this boy and he said he was a Christian, and the first time that he really tried to make a move on her, she turned around and slapped him and said, hey, hold on a second, my daddy told me that you weren't supposed to do that, then it would probably shut that thing down.
Amen.
But if he's like, oh, baby, it's going to be fine, and he's kissing on her neck, and he's nibbling on her ear, then with time, her it's gonna yes. reduce her down, and before you know it, now you're opening up a door. You're being consensual in the situation. Mm-hmm. And when you open up the door, guess what? The devil steps in.
Yeah.
And when the devil steps in, it's real slick, it's real sly, it's real subtle, it doesn't happen immediately, Amen. It's a slow, insidious process, and now when you got demon spirits in the midst of the situation, guess what? You can know all you're supposed to know, but the reality of it is that you're not going to do what you're supposed to do. And many times, churches have been plagued with this. And that's because a lot of it is that we haven't really taught people how to walk in victory. We haven't really stressed the fact that there's a certain way that Christians are supposed to live in comparison to the way the world lives. Listen to me, even though you know the right way to victory, even though you know the right way or the proper object of faith, you still have to be willing to surrender your old carnal ways to the ways of God, and then the Holy Spirit will go to work for you. But if you don't even know the ways of God, if you don't even know how to have proper faith, then you don't even hardly have a chance.
Amen.
Because you can be in church all and you can want to do good, but if you don't know how to access victory, so let me get back and let me answer my question. So why is it that they should not be dating? Because that's the kind of thing that happens. And if the truth about what God's plan is for people's lives is that they're supposed to be fine, what would you say in a Christian relationship between a young lady and a young man, the purpose of that type of relationship would be? I mean, just, does someone want to throw something out there?
Marriage.
To find out if you're compatible for marriage. Yeah. Because the reality of it is, you can think that you would like to be married to somebody, but if you start spending a little bit of time with them, Amen. See, and that's another thing. You can't let the physical aspect of it get involved in it. You start letting the physical aspect of it get involved in it, then now what you've done is you've opened up a door, and it's like, oh, he makes me feel so good when he nibbles on my ear and when he kisses on my neck. Surely he's the one that's meant for me. And the reality of it is that he may not be the one that's meant for you. And now you can't even stand the way he eats. You don't like the way he eats. You don't like the way he looks in the morning. You don't like the way the dude brushes his teeth. He's trying to brush his teeth, but you don't even like the way that he brushes his teeth. And the reality of it is that no, you didn't wait on the Lord. You wanted what you wanted, and you wanted it right now. And he said, give me some of that red stuff. I want some of that pottage, that red stuff. stuff that you're making, and now you found out, no, this wasn't really a good idea, okay? And so all I'm trying to say is this, is that if the purpose in Christian lives is to find out whether or not, now listen to me, parents, because you got a battle ahead of you, buddy. Hey, you got a battle ahead of you, because let me tell you, I know, because I'm a strong-willed person, and and my kids, for the most part, listen, for the most part. I mean, they ain't perfect. Ain't nobody's kids perfect. But for the most part, they listen. I mean, now, they may be hiding some stuff, but if they do it, they doing it behind my back. And all I'm trying to get at is this, is that I know that all I went through, if I went through it, you got some stuff ahead of you, mm-hmm. Jack. And you better learn and be certain on what you believe, because you might not agree with me, and it's okay if you don't. Look, I still love you tomorrow. I hope you come back Wednesday. I hope you come back on Sunday. You don't have to do it the way that I'm trying to explain. I'm just trying to break it down. I'm trying to think in my own mind, how is this stuff supposed to work? How does this look in a godly setting? Amen? And this is what I've come to. And to me, it just sounds right. To me, it sounds like it's right that we aren't supposed to be letting these young people that don't know any better, get themselves involved in this carnal appetite that most of us have been involved in. Yes. And we know how difficult it is to pull away from. Yeah. Come on.
Amen.
The reality of it is that we need to be aware of that. Not only that, not only do they get caught up in sexual relationships early, but they marry people for the wrong reasons.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now, you'll never know how many a young lady who were trained and taught in the ways of God, who left high school and went off to college, and some good-looking dude, the pitcher of the baseball team, the quarterback of the football team, he came talking to them. He wasn't spiritual. He was Esau, man. He didn't know the first thing that there was to know about the things of God. He was a Gentile. He was vain in his thought process. His heart was darkened. His heart was callous. He didn't know the things of God, but boy, he sure was good looking. Mm-hmm. And he sure was sweet to me. And the next thing you know, and guess what? He might even get a baseball contract. And in their mind, you understand, I mean, that's an extreme because very few people actually play college baseball, much less college professional baseball. But the reality of it is that might be an extreme. Maybe he's a mechanical engineer. I don't know. He's an engineer. He's going to be a farmer. He's going to be a surgeon, Daddy. Come on, man. He's going to be a surgeon. I mean, he's making straight A's. My life's set. You know, I know people. You know, I don't know if we should strike it. I don't think these people watch the tape. I know people in my family that have married for that purpose. They may not have come out and told you that, but in the back of their mind, they were thinking, I want a certain lifestyle. Certain people with certain careers are going to be able to provide that lifestyle for me. And that's the choice and the decision that they make to get married for that particular. They don't have any regard whatsoever for the spiritual condition of that person's heart, how they feel about the Lord. Now you made your bed, now you got to sleep in it. See, because if you truly were raised in the truth of God, if you ever did truly get saved, guess what? The Holy Spirit lives in your heart. And one day, I'm telling you, especially if you got a praying mom or daddy, that thing is going to awaken in you. And you're going to wake up and you're going to realize, I've married a person who's an unbeliever. And if the Lord doesn't intervene and save them, now you're sleeping in the same bed with that person who has completely contrary views on the things of God than what you do. And you did it all for material possessions, for what the world offered. And the reality of it is that now you're in the midst of a situation. Listen, God can still bless. God can still do a work. Amen. I'm just trying to make a point. How many times do Christians make decisions? You're not supposed to. From henceforth, don't walk as the other Gentiles walk. But they make decisions like based upon the way Esau would,
amen,
rather than spiritual decisions. They make job and career choices based upon what will bless them now, instead of considering how it will affect their spiritual lives. Listen to me. I know that we live in the midst of an economy and in a situation that some people are like, hold on, preacher. I got to go to work. I get it. Listen to me. I get it. I'm not trying to come against that. So, you know, I used to have to work offshore. But I'm telling you right now, I hated working offshore. And I would try my best to read my Bible out there. But people do what they have to do. But at the same time, there's certain jobs that are not conducive to our spiritual walk. Does that make sense? And before you know it, people will start making excuses. Excuses become easier and easier on why I'm not going to go into the house of God. And all I'm trying to say is that people will make career choices, whether they go into college for something, and not even consider how would this possibly affect my spiritual walk.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll use this as an example. I don't think there's any lawyers in the house. But, you know, I don't know. I'm just going to be honest with you. How do you become a lawyer?
Amen.
And serve the Lord? I'm not trying to say that they don't have any Christian lawyers. Please don't think that I'm judging people. But if you know anything about being an attorney, you pretty much have to lie on a regular basis. I mean, you can't come out. Is anybody married to an attorney in here? Please, if you are, forgive me. I mean, it doesn't mean... You do know that attorneys have to lie quite often.
Yeah.
And once again, I'm not trying to say that there aren't any out there that don't lie. That's not what I'm saying. Surely there's an attorney somewhere in America that doesn't lie. But what I'm trying to get at is the very nature of the job requires them to tell half-truths, untruths.
Yeah.
How do you make a career choice whenever you love the Lord and the Word of God says that He desires truth on the inward parts? Does that make sense? Or, you know, that's just one example. No, basically, though, this. The red man wants the red stuff. He wants to feel good. He wants to feel good now. He puts God, the future, and eternity on the back burner. He says, make my flesh feel good and make it feel good today. All right, the second set of twins I want to talk to you about is Cain and Abel. That comes out of Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. It says, Adam knew Eve, his wife. Genesis 4, 1 through 8. Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. So Cain was the firstborn, and Abel was the secondborn. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering, but unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, another word for angry. He was full of wrath, and his countenance fell. You ever seen somebody with a fallen countenance before? Walk around all droopy with their head down and they're just real sad. The Lord said unto Cain, why are you wroth and why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, shall you not be accepted? And if you do not well, then sin lies at the door. The idea behind the word lie there is that it's crouching. It's like a crouching tiger, an animal that's on its hindquarters ready to spring and to devour, to attack. And unto you shall be his desire. In other words, the sin that's crouching like an animal wants to destroy you, and you shall rule over him. Even though sin wants to devour you, wants to destroy you, God wants us to know, even way back before the first murder takes place on this earth, that he has a plan that would give us power over sin. Cain talked with Abel, his brother. It came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. Some of the things that just stuck out to me in the passage is, number one, Cain makes his living from that which comes from the earth. Once again, we see a connection to the things of the earth, whereas Abel is a keeper of the flocks. They both bring an offering to the Lord. Many times we've discussed these types of things regarding Cain and Abel. We can't say that Cain had no desire whatsoever to serve God because he brought an offering to the Lord. But what he brought was something contrary to the will of God. And what I mean by that is this, is that God had already shown mankind what type of offering he would accept and what type of offering he wouldn't accept. Many times people believe that it was because Abel brought the firstling of the flock and that Cain just brought not the first fruits of the harvest, but just brought an offering. But the reality of it is this, is that God had already showed them through Adam and Eve that the type of offering that had to be given was a blood sacrifice. When they came out with the work of their own hands and put fig leaves on themselves in an attempt to cover their nakedness or their sinfulness, God said, no, this isn't going to work. And he killed the first animal sacrificially, clothing them with the skins of an animal that had nothing to do with the sin that they had committed. This is a type or a foreshadowing or symbolism that paints a picture forward of Jesus, who would die on the cross and pay the penalty for our sin because he had no sin, and so his sacrifice was given in our place. And so we see here that the issue is that Cain, he brings that which he did work with his own hands. I mean, you know, the thing of it is that if you have a garden and you tend it and you keep it, I mean, you can do a whole lot of work in a garden. I mean, if you got a good garden, I mean, if you're a good gardener, you go out there and you pick them weeds out of there. You can, you know, fertilize. You can, like the old King James would say, you could dung it. You could, you know, put some dung on there, fertilize it, make sure you're watering it well, and you could produce some really nice vegetables and some really nice fruit. Then you can take, man, if you're growing eggplant, could you imagine the polish you could put on an eggplant? I mean, I'm just thinking of this as I'm talking. I didn't have it in my nose. But I mean, you could really polish up an eggplant, could you not? I mean, they shine, they're real pretty. You could make a nice little arrangement and bring that unto the Lord. The truth of the matter is that's the difference between man-made religion and true Christianity. In true Christianity, something had to die. Something had to die. Blood had to be shed. The Lord said in the book of Leviticus chapter 17, I've given you blood to make atonement for the soul, for the life of the creature is in the blood. When we talk about the blood of Jesus, what we're really talking about is the fact that his blood was poured out. And the life is in the blood. And so when the blood was poured out, it means that he died. It required the death of the innocent in place of the guilty in order for God to be able to see you and I as clean now instead of still dirty, if you will, or guilty with our original sin that we received from Adam. And so that's what religion does. It wants to be seen. The old carnal nature, the old man like Esau, the flesh, wants to be seen. There's something in each and every one of us that wants to be recognized. We want to be honored. Come on, somebody. No, some of us got it way worse than others. But the reality of it is that in each and every one of us, there's still something. We want to hear somebody praise us. We want somebody to recognize that we did a good job, right? And I mean, to some extent, some of that's okay. But to be honest with you, dude, we go way too far with that. Like, you know, and that's exactly what's happening here. Cain is bringing the work of his own hands before the Lord, and God rejected it. Because the reality is that you can't work hard enough to ever please God. Religion is something external, but Christianity, once again, is something internal. True Christianity, something has to die. Blood has to be shed. Religion works on the outside, and the flesh wants to glory and take credit for it. Amen? Christianity isn't a work of the hands, but on the outside, but it's a work of the heart on the inside. And in this story, the firstborn, the old man, Cain, ends up killing the secondborn, Abel. You know, religion that's built on performance produces the lust of the flesh. Now, we don't have time to go to Galatians chapter 5 this morning, but I can just quickly tell you that if you go to Galatians 5, starting in verse 17, it talks about the fact that it lists off the difference between the lust of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit. The lust of the flesh means things that are in man because of the fall. The flesh, I've told you this before, can mean at least three different things. Sometimes it just talks about physical birth. Talks about your physical birth, that you were born in flesh, physical birth. It can talk about the fact that your flesh is tainted with sin. So in this case, the flesh that's tainted with sin is really talking about the sinful nature. As a matter of fact, where it says in Galatians 5:17, and it talks about, or in 5:17, where it talks about the lust, the flesh lusts against the spirit lusts against the flesh, it's talking about the sinful nature right there. But then also, your flesh can be whenever you attempt to do work in your own strength, to do the work of God in your own strength. Like the Bible says of Abraham, what shall we say of Abraham in Romans chapter 4? What pertaining to the flesh has our father Abraham found? He didn't find anything according to his flesh. In other words, he wasn't able to work the plan of God. The plan of God was a gift. It was a gift of righteousness that was given to him based upon his faith. Amen? And that's the difference. But what we're seeing here is this, is that religion that is built on performance, I need you to understand something, whenever you attempt in your own strength with your own flesh to bring about the righteousness of God, it produces the lusts of the flesh in you. Things like anger, envy, jealousy, to name a few. It produces a lot of other ones. Many times people build their whole Christian idea of who they are in their Christianity based upon what they do in comparison to what other people do. Come on.
Amen.
You look at somebody and you think to yourself, I know I did. I got to be honest with you. And this was after the Lord had gotten a hold of me. When the first time I read the Bible, I looked around and I started thinking, man, nobody else in this place even read their Bible yet. That's a crying shame. And just not long before that, I was realizing, when it hit me, that I had been a Christian for 12 years and hadn't read my Bible yet. Okay? And I understand that there's still Christians that have been Christians for a long time that still haven't read the Bible from cover to cover. I'm not over here telling you that's cool. I don't think it is. At the same time, just because I read the Bible a few times from cover to cover, doesn't make me more righteous in the eyes of God than what you are who only like to read Romans and Revelation. Okay? And so, but yet that's what it does. The flesh, the carnal nature, wants to offer up its works that it's done to God and sees itself as pleasing in the eyes of God, but God rejects that because true Christianity causes death to the old man, which is self, because through faith it dies with Jesus on the cross, amen, and a new man is resurrected to new life. And so that's the difference between the old religion that's not reality and true Christianity. Amen? The third example that I want to use this morning is Isaac and Ishmael. I really should have said Ishmael and Isaac because Ishmael is the firstborn. And, you know, just to tell you the story, so we've kind of switched back and forth chronologically. Jacob and Esau would have been Abraham's grandchildren, right? And Isaac and Ishmael were Abraham's children. And Ishmael, if you remember the story real quick, Sarah's womb was barren. She couldn't have children. And God told them that from them, the whole earth was going to be blessed. They started getting older. And as they got older, they started getting nervous. And Sarah came up with this wonderful plan. Her plan was, see, they had picked up an Egyptian bond slave or an Egyptian slave woman, if you will, a servant, who was part of their household, and Sarah said, why don't you go and sleep with her? Why don't you produce offspring with Hagar? Well, Abraham, he didn't think it through. He said, sure, I'll go do that. And he produced offspring with Sarah. And the name of that child was Ishmael. But God later on tells Abraham, no, your seed isn't going to be through Ishmael. Your seed is going to be through Isaac. And so that's a good point right there for some of you who don't understand why it's not the same God. Abraham's God is different than the God of the Muslims. See, Ishmael is where the Muslims come from. And Isaac is where the Jewish people come from. And Christianity comes from the Jewish people. It's not the same God. And we're not going to get into why it's not the same God, but let me just tell you that it's not. And let me say this, but the scripture is real clear that the seed was to come from Isaac, not through Ishmael. And I've brought that up to Muslim people before, and you know they don't really read the Bible like they're many times like they're supposed to, but the scripture is real clear on that. And so we see the situation where, but God says that no, the promised child is going to come from your loins, and it's going to come from Sarah. And you're going to name him Isaac. And the scripture says in Genesis chapter 21, verses 8 through 12, we're going to read that passage of scripture real quick. Genesis 21, verses 8 through 12. It says, and the child grew and was weaned. Now, we're talking about Isaac now. I'm pretty sure that the situation is that Ishmael is about 13 years old whenever Isaac is born. And the reason I say that is because we know that Ishmael was circumcised at the age of 13. And Isaac was circumcised at 8 days after he was born. The child grew, Isaac, and was weaned. And Abraham made a great feast the same day that Isaac was weaned. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, which she had borne unto Abraham, mocking. Wherefore she said unto Abraham, cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be heir with my son. Now, real quick, we're not really told exactly what the whole mocking thing was there. The literal word means to make sport of. Josephus, who was a Jewish historian, says that he was closer to the time than what. It's not scripture, but I'm just telling you, he was a Jewish historian. His father was a high priest at one time. And so we take some of what he says into consideration. The idea was that Ishmael was an archer, and he would shoot arrows into the woods, and he would tell the young boy, hey, go fetch my arrows. And while he was fetching the arrows, he would shoot arrows and get it kind of dangerously close to where the boy was out there and say, yeah, go get that one over there. And the mom of Sarah was watching this take place. So that's what at least one historian's idea of what mocking was. So in that situation, if that be true, what we see again, just like Cain had the desire to destroy Abel, we see again that the first birth, the identity of the firstborn, wants to destroy the identity of the secondborn. There's a constant battle that's taking place between the old man and the new man. And the old man, he doesn't want to die. He wants to continue to live, and he actually wants to take over. And so it says, cast out this bondwoman and her son, and the son of this bondwoman shall not be heir with my son, even with Isaac. And the thing was very grievous in Abraham's sight because of his son. The word grievous there literally means, yeah, it means to be grieved. It means to be very sorrowful. But even more so, it's kind of like a branch that's broken off. There's a breaking and a separation concept that's connected to it. Whenever she told Abraham, this boy, this bondwoman and this boy have to go, it was very grievous for him. It was like something was being ripped from him. It was being torn away from him, and it was very painful for him. Now, we can look backwards and we can say, well, you ought not have done that to begin with. You should. Well, he did it. He did it just like you and I have done things. And the truth of the matter is, his heart was very connected to this boy. It was his offspring. And the reality of it is that many things that we've done in the flesh, we become very connected to it, and we don't want it to go. But in this particular situation, it had to go because Ishmael and the mama represented the flesh, and Isaac represented the spirit, all right? And so the thing was very grievous in Abraham's sight because of his son. And God said unto Abraham, let it not be grievous in your sight because of the lad and because of thy bondwoman. And all that Sarah has said unto thee, hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called. So in the last example that we're using here, we see the same repetitive pattern where the older or the natural man, the flesh, is looking to destroy and kill the new birth of the spiritual. The scheme of Aaron, Sarah and Abraham would bear a child through the bondwoman in the New Testament. If you could put up Romans chapter 4, excuse me, verse 19, I wanted to show you what this passage of scripture says. Romans 4, 19. Being not weak in faith, he, talking about Abraham, considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. What is that talking about? Well, Abraham believed in faith the word that God spoke to him about Isaac. Even though at this point in time, they were both dead as it regards the possibility of natural childbirth. Does that make sense? Like, time has actually passed. He's 99. She's 90. She's been barren. She couldn't have kids before. She sure ain't gonna be able to have kids now. And at this point in time, physically speaking, they're not gonna give birth. Obviously, whenever Ishmael was born, he wasn't dead in his loins, if you will. He was able to procreate. And he was able to create something in his flesh. Spiritually speaking, this same kind of concept happens to you and I. As long as the flesh or the firstborn idea remains alive in our life, and we have the strength to try to bring forth the promises of God in our own strength, Those things stand in the way of the true promises of God, the spiritual aspect. As we produce things in our carnal flesh, they stand in opposition and prevent the promise of God from coming. It's not until the first birth, the carnal, that which is born that looks like Esau, dies and understands that it has to stop producing things in the flesh. Whatever it is, I don't know, you got to fill in your own blanks, but what I'm trying to talk about is, and I've tried to list these things before, and you know, sometimes you really kind of got to do it in order to make people think about it. Whether, if it comes to relationships. Sometimes we produce things in our own strength according to our own logic to try to fix a situation. You know, whether if I'm a single woman, I'm gonna get me a man. If I'm a single man, I'm gonna get me a woman. And I'm telling you right now that many churches are actually dating sites where people are more concerned. Don't get me wrong, I know that God made them husband and wife and that marriage is a good thing. I'm not trying to say don't get married. But if that's what you're really looking for and you're going to produce that, I'm here to tell you that you may produce a disaster. And that instead to wait on the Lord. Oh, well, that's easy for you to say, preacher. Well, listen to me. I'm just trying to make a point that the reality of it is that you can produce something in your own flesh and it really wasn't God's will. And then you think you had trouble before. No, excuse me, you really got trouble now. And, you know, whether sometimes it's finances. This is the places where we live. So, I mean, don't we? We live in relationships. We live in finances. Sometimes it's finances. I got more month than I got money. All right. Well, so let me concoct a scheme. I'll just get another credit card. They'll give me another credit card. And so now I'm paying Chase Manhattan, the Rockefeller brothers, 20% on my money. And now sometimes people don't have a choice and they don't really know what they're going to do. Listen, I'm not going to get into all the financial stuff. I know that people do the best that they can do. But the reality of it is that, listen, I've been in credit card debt. I still got some credit card debt. I hate credit card debt. But I thank God that I'm not in the credit card debt I was in a long time ago. And it becomes an overwhelming mountain of debt that lays upon you, right? And we have these carnal mindsets that we think, and in a more of a spiritual, practical mindset would be, no, Matt, you just need to learn how to curtail your spending. You keep telling yourself that. You keep telling the congregation that. But that's what you really need to do. You need to learn to curtail your spending. It doesn't matter really how much money you make. You can always spend more than you make. What I'm talking about, as long as you have the power and the strength in your flesh to produce something that you want today, it stands in the way of God's promise when He wants to produce something spiritual in your life. Amen. So obviously Abraham wasn't dead yet when it came to Ishmael, but that whenever it came to Isaac, he was dead at that point in time, and he was the promise of God in that situation. All right, two quick things, and then we're going to get close to closing that I wanted to share with you about the passage regarding Isaac and Ishmael. Number one, I want you to notice or be reminded that he was weaned. You remember that? When we first started reading the text, it said he was weaned. That kind of popped out at me as I was studying the passage of Scripture. He was weaned. Because, you know, the truth of the matter is that in order for a child to grow up, at some point in time, they got to be weaned, right? They got to be weaned off of mama. They got to get, I mean, let's just be real. We're all adults here. We got to wean them off the breast. Now, let me tell you something. You talk about Abraham was grieved. You want to talk about Abraham was grieved whenever Ishmael had to go. You watch a child that's being weaned off his mama's breast. That's a grievous thing. I've seen kids 5, 6 years old walking up to their mama pulling on their dress. That's a little too old to be breastfeeding your baby, all right? But nevertheless, it's a very grievous situation. It's something they hold on to. They find comfort in that situation. They find comfort in nursing and the comfort of their mother. But in order for a a child to grow up, the mama has to realize it's not what's best for you at this point in time. You got to be weaned off of me, and you got to learn how to eat some real food. The reality of it is that when we're in our first birth of Adam, we learned how to find comfort in certain things. In our new birth, like Isaac, at some point in time, we got to be weaned. We got to be weaned from the way that we used to find comfort in the things of the world. You can just, you don't have to close your eyes, but if you would just take a second, if I could shut up for a second, and you could think about some of the ways that you used to find comfort back in the day. Whatever your thing was. I don't know. You have to figure it out. But my point is that you either Esau or you're Jacob. You're either Cain or you're Abel. You're either Isaac, Ishmael, or you're Isaac. And the question is, how are you finding your comfort when the trial comes, when the stress comes? Experience some of this, even as a Christian. That whenever you and I, in our new birth in Christ, if we don't really begin to understand how to go to the Lord in His presence, receive nourishment and instruction from His Word, then what we do is we have a tendency to revert back to what used to bring us comfort in the past. Whatever that thing might be. And the reality of it is that we got to come to the point in time when we realize, no, that's not giving me comfort. The reality of it is that that's keeping me back where I used to be. And it's time now for me to grow up and to move forward and to be weaned. Even in our Christian walk, Peter talks about the fact that we need to be weaned off of milk and we need to be given, move on to meat. Or he talks about the milk of the word. Paul talks about, I couldn't give you meat, I had to give you milk, because you're a babe, because you're still carnal. You're still like the first man. You're thinking fleshly. So you can only handle the superficial concepts regarding the word of God. You can't handle the meat of the word. Amen. Well, at some point in time, you and I, the point I'm trying to make is, we got to grow up. We got to grow up. We got to be weaned off of the things that the old carnal nature found comfort in. And now we got to move forward, amen, and start to find our comfort in the Lord. Praise God. And that's a beautiful thing when you start to find that. Yeah. Amen. When you start to find that. But once again, Esau don't want to die. Esau wants to kill Jacob. Ishmael wants to kill Isaac. Cain wants to kill Abel. The old man wants to live. And he still wants to go nurse on his mama. Or, you know, he don't want to die. He don't want to leave. All right. The flesh had to go. That's number two. Number one, Isaac had to be weaned. And number two, the flesh had to go. See, the flesh only just serves to distract from the spirit. Not only does it want to kill the promise of God, but it's a constant reminder that there's another place to find comfort. But that comfort is nothing more than a mirage. And so we see that in the new birth, there are many challenges to our Christian walk. See, the truth of the matter is that as long as Hagar and Ishmael were there, it was going to cause difficulty for the spirit to continue to grow. And the reality of it is that the flesh had to go. And so when we look at all of these things to come together, because essentially that's the end of my two scenarios, is that God, number one, God's plan is to birth in us a desire for heavenly things and spiritual things that will bring Him glory and honor. Things that we have to wait on patiently through faith. Yeah. You can't be like Esau and just want the red pottage. You can't want the here and now, right now, and think that God's promises are going to be able to come to you the way that... As a matter of fact, if you put on the screen Hebrews chapter 6, verse 12... It says in Hebrews 6:12 that you be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Yes. See, the faith part isn't always the hardest part. Lord, we believe you're real. Lord, we believe you have a plan to give us grace. But the patience part. The word patience, really, I didn't even look it up. I'm going to be honest with you. But I know it is. If I had my phone... Well, while I'm walking to the board, I do have my phone. And if I make myself to be a fool, then it won't be the first time.
I didn't look it up, but like I said, I'm quite certain that the word patience right here is... Nope. See, I was wrong. So I'm not even going to do it. But the idea of patience, we do know that patience... Let's see what it does say. It says, long-suffering, patience, endurance, constancy, steadfastness, perseverance. You don't give up easy. You don't quit at the first sign of trouble. So it requires faith and patience. And the endurance part is usually really the hardest part. Amen. To hold on. To trust. Many times we're left really with the situation that we have to ask ourselves is, am I willing to trust God in the midst of this situation, even if the promise that I thought I was looking for never comes to pass? Will I serve Him through faith even till the end in that situation? Oh, we have biblical precedents for that. Abraham never saw the promises of God that God had given him. Yet he sojourned in the land. He looked for a city whose builder and maker was God. Amen? And so he never saw the promises of God fulfilled. Jacob never saw the promises of God fulfilled in his life. And so sometimes on this earth, the reality of it is, I mean, this isn't the kind of preaching that people flock to, but it's just the truth. Sometimes on this earth, the promises that we have desires for in our heart, they just don't come to pass on this side. But the question is, will we, through faith and patience, persevere with the Lord? See, because the flesh sees the red stuff, like Esau, and the stuff of the world that appeals to our carnal desires and entices us to grab something now for immediate satisfaction instead of waiting on the promise. Part two, or the second thing that I want you to know about. There's a part to the natural man that wants to be seen and recognized by man. Our flesh is an external form of religion that seeks praise of man and results in Christians that think more highly of themselves than what they ought to. Did you know that? Performance-based Christianity makes Christians think more highly of themselves than what they ought to. Look at what I do. Look at what you don't do. That's not of the Lord. Amen? And what true Christianity is connected to a sacrifice. Both Abel and his offering died. And in a spiritual sense, that's the gospel. Jesus died on the cross, and through faith in him, we die also with him there and receive a new resurrection life. Number three, the last point. There's a process of weaning that must take place. Spiritual maturity that learns to grow in the ways of God, trusting in him and his word, and rejecting the schemes and plans of the old life.